Good morning, friends. Welcome to worship with Moreland Presbyterian Church in Portland, Oregon. I'm Brian Marsh, the pastor here, and so thankful to be with you again on this wintry Sunday morning in the season of Epiphany. Especially want to welcome those of you who may be joining us for the first time or for whom Moreland is an occasional connection. We are so glad that you are taking time out of your Sunday morning or whatever time you may be viewing this in the course of this coming week. Thank you for taking the time. The connection is real. It's not just virtual. And we who connect together can sense it. And it is a real gift to be able to continue to connect in these times. We at Moreland are a group of ordinary people. We're an ordinary church. We are experiencing an extraordinary love. It's what connects us together. It's what gives us life and hope. And our hope is that each of us will have a chance to experience that love in our times together and in our daily lives and share that love with each other and with our community and our world. As we gather each week together, we have cause for celebration, and we also come needing comfort and understanding. We celebrate today that Cindy McCann, one of our longtime Morelanders, is celebrating a birthday. Happy birthday to Cindy. And we are also recognizing a couple of our families who are needing an extra measure of comfort today, as we grieve the losses of Dick Strom, who passed away this past week, and Bob Steed, who passed away just over a week ago. And so we are thinking of Dick and Bob and their families on this day, giving thanks for lives so well led, and also praying for that comfort and peace to surround and infill their dear families. So we come bringing all of ourselves and our life experiences together into a time of worship. And so let's enter into that time now, first through our call to worship.
When we are pulled in so many directions, we end up dizzy. You are our center, O God. When duties and demands keep us infinitely busy, you are our peace, O God. When life throws us questions and there are no answers, you are our wisdom, O God. For a safe space to pause, to breathe, to be, to belong, we give you thanks, O God. Amen.
Our hymn of praise is Our God, Our Help in Ages Past. Let's open our hearts and lift our voices together.
A thousand ages in thy sight are like an evening gone. Short as the watch that ends the night before the rising sun.
Whenever we come together as a community, we give thanks for the marvels, the amazement, the gifts of mystery and majesty in our lives. We recognize how many of those gifts are timeless, as our scriptures remind us, in the economy and the perspective of the divine. A day is like 1,000 years, 1,000 years is like a day. We bring our amazement and our awe into a space like this together. We also bring our astonishment and our awe at the brokenness that we experience around us, in our world, in our nation, in our communities, in our own lives. And we come together to bring all of that into this safe, that is, this space that is sacred and safe. In the presence of the one who has made us, the one who knows us, the one who loves us, the one who is love. And so let's enter into a time of reflection and release. We'll do that first in song, the next verse of Our God, Our Help in Ages Past, and then followed by some moments of silence. Let's join together in prayer.
Brian, you need to unmute.
Praise be to God. Amen.
Sorry, friends. The imperfections are always present. So often, all that is visible is uncertainty and insecurity. But the visible reality is a hope that is stronger than fear and a love that connects us all. In Jesus the Christ, we are accepted. We are forgiven. We are loved. Thanks be to God. Amen. And now let's sing our grateful response.
Our God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come. Be thou our guide, our life shall last on our eternal home.
And now, friends, the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. And also with you. Let's take a few moments and pass that peace with those with whom you are sheltering in the comment section on Facebook Live, phone call, text message, shout out to neighbor, any means available to you. Know that the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ is with us all, and peace be with you.
Good morning and peace to you all. Last week in Sunday school, we had the story of baptism, a story of belonging that ends with the call to see the light of Christ in all people. And this week, we have a story that most children can relate to, a story of worried parents and of being lost and not really lost, of being in exactly the right place. The story of Jesus as a boy in the temple. So now I invite children to Sunday school. You can find the link to the Google Meet in the chat, or it was in the Thursday e-notes or the family emails that went out to our families list. So see you there.
Good morning. Our first reading today is from Amos 6, 1 through 7, and I'll be reading here from the Inclusive Translation. Woe to you who live in luxury in Zion, and to you self-important people on the mountain of Samaria, you distinguished leaders of the nation in whom the house of Israel places their hope. Cross over to Calneh and see. Go on from there to Hamath the Great, then down to Gath in Philistia. Are you better off than these realms? Is their territory larger than yours? Yet you try not to think about the day of woe, and you hasten the reign of violence. Lying on ivory beds and reclining on their couches, they dine on lambs from the flock and young calves from the stalls. They hum to the tune of their harp and fancy themselves musicians like David. They drink wine straight from the bottle and anoint themselves with finest oils, but they show no care for the ruin of Joseph. That is why they will be the first to be exiled. They will recline no more at festive banquets.
And from Hebrews 10, verses 32 to 39. Call to mind those earlier days after you had been enlightened, when you stood your ground in a great struggle of suffering. Sometimes you were exposed to insults and violence. Sometimes you stood by associates who received such treatment. You joined in the suffering of those in prison. You gladly accepted the confiscation of your property, for you knew that you possessed something better and lasting. So don't throw away your confidence. It will provide you with a great reward. You'll need endurance to carry out God's will and receive what has been promised. In just a little while, the one who is coming will come and will not delay. The just will live by their faith, but if they hesitate, I will take no pleasure in them. You and I are not the sort to hesitate and be lost by it. We are the sort who have faith and are saved.
And friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And thanks be to Duncan Robertson and Eileen Kennedy for providing our beautiful readings for this morning. Let's join now together for some moments to breathe and to pray. Gracious God, we are thankful. We're thankful for words that can both challenge us and comfort us. Words that can encourage us and empower us. And we thank you for these words from your scriptures. And we ask now that by your presence, your spirit, you might speak them into the pages of our lives in ways that we can hear and know and understand. So may the words of my mouth and the thoughts and dreams and meditations of our hearts be a delight to you. For God, you are our delight. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
A while back, just before the pandemic commenced, I was connecting with a dear old friend, and we were reminiscing about how we met back in school. And we both remembered that same event, the same day, the same setting, the same circumstances. And I remembered him leaving his comfort zone, the circle of his friends, and taking the initiative, showing the courage to walk across the room and to engage me in conversation. He remembered me leaving the comfort of my circle of friends and taking the initiative, running the risk of walking across the room to engage him in conversation. So which one was it? I mean, we experienced the same event, and yet we experienced it and remembered it very differently. I mean, clearly one of us must be remembering it correctly and the other remembering it not quite correctly. If there isn't one correct way to experience and remember something, then what? Well, if you're like me, and you've had an experience like that, you may have felt like the whole world was slipping sideways and you were slip sliding away into something like the Twilight Zone, a space that is disorienting and also terrifying. The current realities in our world in which we live nowadays are much more convoluted and much more complex than a simple difference of remembrance among friends. We are bombarded daily with deeply conflicting versions of what is right and wrong, what is real and fake, what is just and unjust. And with more divergent information shared more passionately and forcefully at an increasing volume and speed, the cacophony only seems to confirm and entrench us in our distinct biases and perspectives, and make basic communication and mutual understanding seemingly impossible. Well, in the midst of all of this, where is that shared basis for our experience of reality as people? Where might we find our common sense of security that comes from that shared experience and understanding. Where might we find and discover our mutual sense of sensibility and sensitivity? Two ancient prophets have some reality adjusting and clarifying words for us today. The prophet Amos, the rural farmer of ancient Israel, is speaking out against the urban elites of his time, and they don't want to hear what he has to say. To use a current term, he calls them out. He calls out their sense of exceptionality and entitlement that's formed their sense of security as people of privilege and power, no matter how false that sense of security may actually be. And how that false sense of security has desensitized them to their actual calling in welcoming in all of those who have been exiled and exhausted by the intensive challenges of life without that power and privilege. He rages against the machinery of prosperity that can make it so easy to downplay the seriousness and the urgency of the crises in their world. And I'm wondering, is that ringing any bells of familiarity for you? Because the bells are sure ringing in my head and my heart when I hear his words. If you happen to be a person like me, a person of privilege, with our basic needs continuing to be met and our essential connections continuing to be sustained, even through a global pandemic, it can be more difficult to hear the cries of those who are suffering from lack of basic provisions and connections. The hungry, the houseless, the jobless, those who are distressed and oppressed because of daunting life circumstances, because of their cultural heritage, because of their personal identity. And even as those beloved neighbors of ours exist right in front of us on our streets, they can actually be harder to see since we are increasingly existing from a physical and social distance, safe and secure in our homes. And this has the effect of shrinking our circles of community and connection, which in turn can lead us to more naturally and easily fall into a pattern of listening only to the voices that sound like ours, the voices that resonate with our deepest personal perspectives and convictions and beliefs, which in turn not only isolates us even further from each other, but also entrenches us in our visions and versions of what is real and true more deeply within ourselves and among ourselves, which in turn only more powerfully confirms our innate sense of being somehow exceptional. For whatever reasons, justified or otherwise, regardless of which end of the societal spectrum we may land, we can draw a powerful sense of security from this perception and experience of exceptionality. That while we're definitely not perfect, at least we're not misguided in our convictions. At least not misguided like those others. No wonder it's so hard to discern and acknowledge a common sense of what the actual facts are in our lived experiences these days. In his powerful question to Jesus, Pontius Pilate asks, "What is truth?" That is the question of our times. Like my friend and me, we can share a common event and experience it and remember it very differently. And this can start to kind of play with our minds and even our sense of reality. It can stoke our uncertainties and our fears, which can then drive us further into our bunkers of safety and sameness, protecting ourselves not only from those unthinkable realities of life that our fellow beloved neighbors are living in every day, but also those seemingly unbearable convictions of others. But in realizing this pattern, I'm reminded of something. I'm reminded that living with the privilege of perceiving ourselves as exceptional does not entitle us to be exclusional. Exposing ourselves to those unthinkable realities of our marginalized neighbors and those unbearable convictions that others hold to our chagrin can actually lead us initially to withdraw inward in resistance and fear, in the uncertainty and the unknown. But this drawing inward can actually then open us into a deeper experience of what is in the depths of us, the love at the core of our being, the love that made us, the love of which we are made, the love that embraces our fears and transforms them and integrates their energy into our true selves, which then can open us to that even deeper reality that can empower us into a broader engagement with others and the harsher realities in our world. Opening our eyes and ears can actually lead us to opening our hearts more deeply and fully. And this reminds me of the community of faith addressed in the letter to the Hebrews, a community who allowed themselves to enter more deeply into the sordid realities of others and stand with them and for them in solidarity. The confidence and endurance to do so emerging from that deeper reality within themselves and among themselves to help them be people less of entitlement and more of empowerment, less complaining and more caring, embodying less exclusivity and more inclusivity. A people willing to lose their sense of security based in superiority in order to find a deeper sensitivity and sensibility and solidarity. I wonder, what might this confidence, this endurance look like for us today? Well, it might look like remembering. Remembering that we, first and foremost, are relational beings, and that relationships are not only the core of the fabric of our society, relationships take time. They take time and effort and intentionality and courage and trust to develop inch by inch, step by step, day by day, being present, showing up regularly in each other's lives. Remembering that regardless of our divergent experiences and perceptions and convictions, we all bleed the same blood and we all breathe the same air. It might look like recognizing that there is real pain in our world, in our community, in our lives, and that we are called, first and foremost, to listen to the pain in order to empathize and understand it, not to agree or argue about it or take it away somehow, even if and when it makes us feel unsettled and uncomfortable. Listen, empathize, understand, respond, repeat. This confidence and endurance might look like recognizing that there are also real expressions of evil in our world and in our community and in our lives. There are injustices and inequalities that need to be called out and brought to light to awaken us into deeper awareness and action. And rather than resorting to calling out others in ways that communicate condemnation and nothing else, realizing that those necessary times of calling out injustice and inequality can actually be a gateway to a broader and deeper calling in to conversation and communication and relationship. Remembering that while evil indeed is a threat, in our essential core of our being, in our heart of hearts as people, we are not a threat. Ultimately, I sense that this confidence and endurance might look something like faith. Faith in the presence that is ever present, knowing that there is a perpetual source of encouragement and empowerment within us and among all of us through all times, which can inspire us and fan our flame of desire to share love and hope through working for justice and equality for all of us. I wonder, what if we were known as being exceptional? Exceptional listeners, exceptional learners, exceptional advocates, exceptional servants of others. What if we opened our ordinary selves to offer our exceptional gifts to each other in extraordinary, beloved community? May we hear the invitation today to lose our false sense of security based in superiority and find our deeper, more divinely human sense of sensitivity and sensibility and solidarity through these simple and yet profound words from Shel Silverstein. If you are a dreamer, come in. If you are a dreamer, a wisher, a liar, a hoper, a prayer, a magic bean buyer, if you're a pretender, come sit by my fire. For we have some flax golden tales to spin. Come in. Come in. Come in. Amen.
Dear God, we come to you today and ask for your compassion and care and comfort as we seek direction together. We ask for comfort for those of us who are in pain and grieving. Especially today, we lift up the families of Dick Strom and Bob Steed as we grieve their passing and celebrate two lives so well lived. We hope to live our lives so fully and well. We come to you today, ever seeking to continue living our lives with integrity and virtue and kindness while we have the time gifted to us here on this earth. So this morning, we offer you this prayer by Reverend Elizabeth Lott, for the kind of honesty necessary to live the lives which you call us to lead. Let's be honest in this moment so that we aren't wasting anybody's precious time. Let's be honest about the worst of who we are. Honest with ourselves, honest with each other, honest with you. Let's be honest about our apathy, our shame, our obsessions, our addictions, our self-harm, self-numbing, self-neglect. These ways surround us, cling to us, hover over us like a cloud not yet burned off by the morning sun. And so we own up to these ways. We hold them out in the light before you, before each other, before ourselves. This is who we are. And so now, let's again be honest in this moment so that we aren't wasting anybody's precious time. Let's be honest about the best of who we are. Honest with ourselves, honest with each other, honest with you. Before we dare to claim these words about ourselves, we need you to remind us that we were lovingly made in your image. We need you to remind us that your wild and daring spirit is in our breath. We need you to remind us that Jesus came to us as flesh and blood, taking on the name God with us, because these lives and these bodies matter so very much. Let us be honest about our capacity to create and imagine. Let us be honest about our depth of empathy and compassion. Let us be honest about our deep love, burning passion, hearts for justice, care for our neighbors, abiding hope in a better day. Let's be honest about our eye for beauty as we notice a bloom, a dewdrop on a leaf, the smile of our love. Let's be honest about our ear for goodness as we hear the streetcars rumble by, as we cozy up on a quiet afternoon and listen to the rain falling around, as we delight in the laughter of children, as we weep at the beauty of a favorite song and dance barefoot in the kitchen, overcome by the rightness of a moment. Oh God, let's be honest. We are all these things. We are sinners and we are saints. We are surrounded by clouds of both. We are harsh and beautiful. We are cruel and kind. We are apathetic and passionate. We can barely stand it, the complexity of this life. Be gracious with us, O God, and remind us every day to be gracious with each other and with ourselves as we set out once again for the level paths to you. Amen.
As we continue journeying these days together as imperfect vessels of a perfect love, we do so through different opportunities that continue and other new opportunities to come. As has been the case these past several weeks, our pause and ponder experiences continue. Earth, our original monastery, the contemplative prayer series with resources that you can engage with individually. Those are available via link through our e-notes and in the comments section here. I want to make special mention that there will be a pause and ponder conversation on Zoom on Sunday, February 14th at 12 noon. And that'll be following our annual congregational celebration and meeting. So we invite you to mark your calendars and be a part of that conversation on the 14th at noon. Also want to highlight that our weekly Wednesday morning gathering for scripture and conversation happens at 8 a.m. every Wednesday on Zoom, and that all people, all genders are welcome to join us in a time that is always thoughtful and engaging, with plenty of good laughter and with plenty of wisdom to inspire and challenge and encourage us all. Wednesday mornings at 8 a.m. on Zoom. There is an upcoming Valentine crafting event on February 3rd. And this is connected with Logos and our children's ministries. And there will be two sessions available on the 3rd. And there is a sign up link in the comment section and in e-notes. And it's going to be a great event. And of course, we have a contingency plan in case of icky weather that will have the supplies for crafting available to go on that day as well. But there's more information at the link and in our e-notes. But we invite you to mark your calendars for that one as well, a chance to be creative and to be creative together. Also a reminder that we have started up Sunday morning Sunday school online, as Sarah has introduced it in worship and will continue to introduce it. It's an exciting time for children and their parents to interact with Sarah and other children's ministry leaders in our Godly Place stories. And so we invite you to follow that link onto Google Meet. And that's around 9:45 each Sunday morning. We'd love to see you there. Friends, as we've mentioned, all that we have, all that we are, this gift of life itself is a gift. And we are so thankful for the gifts that we have to share. As leadership of the Moreland community would attest, along with me, we are so grateful to each of you for all of the ways that you are able and are contributing your time, your heart, your faith, your energy, your talents, your treasures with us, so that we can continue to be a gateway of connection for our broader community. We thank you also for all the ways that you are directly supporting other communities of faith in your areas and the nonprofits that are doing that work that is so vital and essential on a day in, day out basis to provide essential provision for those in greatest need. We are humbled by your ongoing generosity, and we appreciate all of the ways that you are being creative in reaching out to others and meeting those needs in any and every way that we can. And so now, with gratitude to the one who is the giver of all good gifts, let's pause and present our gifts and tithes and offerings. Thank you. Friends, as we give thanks for all of God's good gifts, let's do that through the prayer that Jesus taught his first followers to pray, the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father in heaven, holy is your name. May your kingdom come, may your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we are our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Advise the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thanks, Ian. Our hymn of sending is Faith Begins by Letting Go.
Faith begins by letting go, giving up what had seemed sure, taking risks and pressing on, though the way feels less secure. Pilgrimage both right and wrong, trusting all our life to God. Faith endures by holding on, keeping memories roots alive, so that hope may bear it fruit. From its fed, our souls will thrive. Not through merit we possess, but by God's great faithfulness. Faith matures by reaching out, stretching minds, enlarging hearts, sharing struggles, living prayer, finding of the broken parts. Will we find the common place, right with witness to God's grace?
And now, friends, I invite you to gather close with those with whom you're sheltering. As we gather close in spirit and close our time together, friends, may we remember the true source of our security is the source of our sensitivity and sensibility and solidarity. The security that comes not through superiority, but through humble recognition and celebration of the other, of each of us as a beloved child of our Creator, with unique and extraordinary and exceptional gifts. May we be exceptional listeners and exceptional learners, exceptional advocates, and exceptional servants of all. And may God bless us and keep us. May God's face shine upon us. May God's grace shine within us. And may God's loving and life-giving presence be within us and with us, among us and beyond us, this day and every day. And now, our musical benediction.
There at the table, with my head in my hands, a column of numbers I just did not understand. You said, add these together, carry the two. Now you can do this hard thing. You can do this hard thing. It's not easy, I know, but I believe that it's so. You can do this hard thing. At a cold winter station, breathing into our gloves. It would change me forever, leaving for God knows what. You carried my bags, you said I'll wait for you. You can do this hard thing. You can do this hard thing. It's not easy, I know, but I believe that it's so. You can do this hard thing. That late night I called, and you answered the phone. The worst it had happened, and I did not want to be alone. You quietly listened. You said we'll see this through. You can do this hard thing. You can do this hard thing. It's not easy, I know, but I believe that it's so. You can hard thing. There we stand, pressed with our hearts in our hands. Hearts hung like laundry on backyard clotheslines. Impossible just takes a little more time. From the muddy ground comes a green volunteer. In a place we thought barren, new life appears. Morning will come whistling some comforting tune for you. You can do this hard thing. You can do this hard thing. It's not easy, I know, but I believe that it's so. You can do this hard thing. Believe that it's so. You can do this hard thing.
And all of God's children say,
Amen.
Thanks so much, dear Brenda, for reminding us again that we can do this hard thing. We are doing this hard thing. And thanks, as always, to Evan Miles and Tracy Ross for their beautiful music and technical prowess, to Sarah Gibson for her powerful storytelling for our children and parents and families, to Jeannie Witten for sharing such wisdom and creativity in her worship leadership and prayer leadership, for Melissa Ferguson keeping us all connected, not only on Sundays, but throughout the week. And to each of you, thank you for being a part of what makes us, us. May you be encouraged to do the hard things in the week to come. And may you be empowered and delighted in the moments that aren't so hard, where we can breathe and be and give thanks and celebrate. I love you all. and wish you all God's richest and deepest peace in the week ahead. Take care, and we will see you next Sunday.